Hello, I am Gabriel. I am lead pastor of Grace Communion Richardson, and I just want to welcome you to our Sunday worship stream. Here at Grace Communion Richardson, we seek to know Jesus and to make him known through worship, through family fellowship, and through community or neighborhood engagements, all flowing out of the compelling love of God expressed in our Savior, Jesus Christ. You are most welcome to our stream today. We would like to know where you are watching from, so please don't hesitate to share where you are watching from and who you are watching with. It is interesting to know that detail. Also, please feel free to share your prayer needs with us. If you have any prayer requests, you can see the address that you can send prayer requests to on the screen. We will be more than glad to pray for you and with you as we go through these very uncertain times, these very anxious times and fearful times for a lot of people. So please don't hesitate to send us your prayer requests if you have any, and we will pray with you. As you may already have noticed, Grace Communion Richardson is a diverse group of people. And we are diverse not only ethnically, but in so many other ways as well. We value diversity as a gift from God. We seek to get to know each other respectfully. We seek to get to know each other deeply. We seek to want to listen to each other, to love each other, and to value each other as sharing the same common humanity that God has blessed us with in sharing his image with us, as we are made in the image and likeness of God, and also in the understanding of our shared identity in Jesus Christ and his incredible love. So, if you want to know more about us, please feel free to reach out and we will love to respond to you. At this stage, I want to invite you to join our praise team as they share a praise song with us. And hopefully when you listen to these praise songs, hopefully they are uplifting to you, they are inspiring to you, and they are motivating and hopeful to you to know and to trust the Lord that he is with us during these difficult times, and that he is ultimately working all things out for good. That is what he does. We are not alone. He's got this. So join our praise team as they share a song, and then Richard will share a prayer, and then we'll have Leo read the scripture for today, and then I'll come back with a word of thanks for your generosity, and then we'll get into the main message for today, which is about the fact that neither life, neither death nor life can separate us from the love of God, which is in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Please stay with us.
Good afternoon. Thank you for joining us today. Psalm 150, verse 6. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord with us.
Strange. Lord, I will lift good my eyes to your throne, and I will follow all of your ways, and I'll give you all my worship, and I will give you all my praise. You alone, I long to worship. You alone are worthy of my praise. I will bow down
and hail you as King.
Holy God, our Father, I join the many in the universal body of Jesus Christ in asking for your promised grace and mercy to fall upon this broken and sin-crazed world, to stem the tide of this pandemic that is wreaking havoc on our economies and our well-being. I especially pray for your grace and mercy in these areas, that you would bring my nation and this world to the healing as only possible in you. For the sick and affected, God, I ask that you would heal and help, sustain bodies and spirits, contain the spread of this virus for our vulnerable populations, God protect our elderly and those suffering from chronic illnesses. For the young and vibrant, may they be cautious for the sake of others. May they be inspired to help, to turn from their anger and their restlessness, to build up and not tear down. For our local, state, and federal government, our elected officials, to lead by example, to restore peace, stop the lawlessness. God, you ordained government to protect its people. I beseech you to hear the cries of those suffering in the midst of racial strife and injustices. For our scientific and health community leading the way, trying to understand the disease and communicate its gravity. God, give them a knowledge. Give them wisdom and a persuasive but honest voice. Protect and gird up the health workers. Sustain them through the long hours and the emotional pressure they work under. For workers in a variety of industries facing layoffs and financial hardship, God, keep them from panic and inspire your church to generously support as we can. Keep families together to be able to withstand the onslaught of despair. For leaders in industry who are having to make hard decisions, please, God, give them wisdom regarding their workers. Give them compassion. For schools, colleges, and universities whose courses are changing, whose placements are canceled, whose graduation is uncertain, God, show them that while life is uncertain, their trust can be in you. God, we trust that you are good and do good. Teach us to be your faithful people in this time of global crisis. Help us to be the light in the darkness that overshadows this world. We rejoice in your Son, that all evil that has been perpetrated in this world has been placed upon your Son. And by his righteous life, we have hope in you. Thank you, Father, for this. We can be encouraged by your promises. Especially I think of Joel that talks about the destruction that came and destroyed the land. And that you said one day you would pour out your Spirit upon this earth. Empower your church universal to speak boldly of your grace and mercy. In the name of your Son, we pray, knowing you equip us with every good work. I ask your blessing upon this service and your people. In Jesus' name, amen.
For the reading of Scripture today, we will be reading Romans 8, 26 through 39. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance to the will of God. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those he predestined, he also called. And those he called, he also justified. Those he justified, he also glorified. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither present nor future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Thank you so very much to our praise team for that worship song, and also to Richard for the prayer and Leo for the scripture reading. I just want to at this time say a heartfelt thank you to Grace Communion Richardson members and supporters, and all those of you out there who share our values, who've been financially supporting our gospel effort. Thank you for your generosity and for your generous lifestyle, not only in terms of financially supporting, but also in terms of prayers and in terms of practical things that you do in support of this gospel effort, and also in support of others around you in your sphere of influence that you are able to help. If you want to share in this gospel effort with us financially, you can see on the screen some of the ways that you can do so. And please know that your financial contributions are tax deductible. Thank you so very much. Welcome back to the main message for today. And the title for this stream is Neither Death Nor Life. Neither death nor life. As we live in this already and not yet time between times of trials and triumphs, pains and relief, suffering and joy, death and life, God is with us and for us through it all. That's important for us to remember, especially when we're going through difficult times. The creation groans, we groan, the Spirit of God groans with us, and God groans with us and acts for us. Between now and inheriting the done deal, which we talked about last Sunday, the done deal of ultimate, abundant, resurrected, and glorious life, of love and joy as children of God, God works all things together for our good. Neither death nor life can separate us from the love that God has for you and for me, which is in Jesus Christ, our Lord. And we want to look at that today. And I'm hoping that at the end of the message, you would feel encouraged, and you will feel hopeful, and you will feel inspired, and you will rest in that truth and live out the beautiful implications of that truth. Where do you find meaning in this topsy-turvy world? Some believe that life is purposeless. Life really has no meaning. You just make the most of it right now, because as the Apostle Paul puts it in 1 Corinthians 15, let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. Some believe that this life is all fate. It is meaningless, purposeless, and it's just a matter of fate. A random confluence of events. Is that what you believe? Well, the Apostle Paul's letter to the Romans tells us otherwise. In fact, it tells us that life has rich meaning and life has rich purpose because God has set his love on us. Not just humans alone, but in fact, even on all of his creation. As a result of that, life is not just a matter of fate, that anything can happen randomly and purposely. Rather, life has meaning in Jesus Christ, his Son. So let's go to Romans chapter 8. We've been looking at the 8th chapter of Romans for the past few Sundays. And today we're going to be concluding as we look at the rest of the verses in Romans chapter 8. Remember, I hope that you do, that in previous messages, in previous Sundays, we had gone over Paul's statement in Romans chapter 7, at the tail end of Romans 7, where he sets up this truth that on our own or for ourselves, we are inexorably subject and headed to death. And so he cried out at the end of it, who is going to save me? As he was very vulnerable in saying that. He's not always able to do what he knows is right. Who is going to save me, he said, from this body that is headed to death, that is subject to death? And then he provided the answer, thank God, through Christ Jesus. And then in verse chapter 8, which is what we've been looking at the past few Sundays, explains how that rescue works. And so let's continue. Last Sunday, we stopped at verse 25 of Romans chapter 8, and we pick up Paul's reasoning and Paul's sharing from verse 26. So I thank Leo for sharing this scripture. I'm going to just take excerpts from it. In verse 26, the 8th chapter of Romans, Paul says, in the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weaknesses. Whoa, let's pause for a moment right there and clarify a truism. Here is Paul saying that Christians have what? Weaknesses. So this point has already been made and it doesn't hurt to repeat it. Just because we are Christians does not mean that we are perfect, or it does not mean that we are always on the ball doing the right things, that we have all the strength and all the wisdom and all the knowledge to make the right choices and decisions. No, we have weaknesses. But, and this is where Christians differ from those who are yet to believe, he says that in our weaknesses, the Spirit helps us. The Spirit is available for us in our weaknesses. Let's continue. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit Himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. So he says, even when it comes to prayer, which is just sharing with God from the heart, which is conversing with God from the heart, your anxieties, your fear, your dreams, your joys, your hopes, your intercessions on behalf of others, your supplications and whatnot. It says even that we really don't know how to do it well. However, the Spirit engages and helps us in that. Verse 27, he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. So even the act of prayer, Paul is encouraging us to know that we are not alone even when we engage in prayer. I hope that is encouraging to you, because I know a lot of us struggle with prayer. I know many a time I have started to pray and I don't remember when I finished, because I may have fallen asleep or have been distracted by something else. And that happens. And it is very easy to get discouraged about some of these things. And Paul is encouraging us that, yes, even in our prayer life, the Spirit is there to help us. He had already said earlier that we have weaknesses and the Spirit helps our weaknesses. So in life, in our day-to-day living, Paul is saying the Spirit is available as our help. And that's why the Spirit is called the helper. You know, we covered this again at previous Sundays. The Spirit is available as a helper. The Spirit is available as a coach, as a connector, as a companion. The Spirit helps us. And then in verse 28, he says that, and we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. Now, this verse 28 is a popular verse. A lot of people are aware of this verse. A lot of people quote this verse. All things work together for good. All things work together. I'm sure you probably have heard this before if you've been a believer for any length of time, or if you've been around believers or Christians. Another way of saying this is that all things work together. All things work together for good to those who love God. Okay? All things work together. That's how some translations put it. Another way of saying it is that in all things, God works together with those who love Him to bring about what is good. I like that. I like that latter way of putting this verse. In all things, God works together with those who love Him to bring about what is good. Because that's what really what God is doing with us, isn't it? As Christians and as churches and as ministries, as charities and so on. God is working with us to bring about good. Another way of putting it is, God has invited us to participate in what He is doing, which is good. Because God is good. All of the time, God is good. And He has called us to participate in His goodness, in His mission and ministry of love. That's beautiful to me, that God just doesn't just step in every time and just take care of things. No, He works with us. We are involved in the process, just as we do as parents, those of us who are parents, or even guardians, or teachers, mentors, and so on. We work together. That's a godly thing. That's flowing from God, this human trait of working together, right? Purposefully, not just by instinct as animals do, but purposefully, reasonably, deliberately, in a way that you can even change and make course corrections together. That is a gift from God. And Paul is telling us here, that's how God works with us. And as you read these verses, friends, I hope you begin to realize that Paul is describing the fact that God is present in our lives. God is incarnate in our lives. God is not distant out there just watching us fumble and mumble along in life. No, He is in it with us through His Spirit. He recognizes our weaknesses. He recognizes our strengths. He recognizes when we do not even know whether we have a weakness or a strength. He's in it with us. He's in the arena with us. He's not just a bystander criticizing or critiquing what we are doing. Even though He holds us accountable, He holds us accountable within the context of being in it with us. So He is, in that sense, not just a mere Monday morning quarterbacking. No, for those of you who are into sports and football, God is not that way. God is in the arena with us. Paul is telling us with verse 28. God is with us in the ups and in the downs of life and sees us through whatever the ups and the downs may be for good. For good. There is meaning and purpose in life. That's really what Paul is saying here. It is not all for naught. Whether the failures or the successes have meaning and purpose, because God makes it so. I know you've heard many times from others who say, it is God's plan. God has a plan for my life. Or that whatever it is that happened to them, this is as a result of God's plan. Whether it's good or bad. Well, I don't think that's just how that works. I believe that because we are human beings with agency, that is to say human beings with the ability to make choices, to make decisions, that we sometimes make decisions that are not for our good and for the good of others around us, our family and loved ones are impacted by it. But then God steps in and God helps us. That's what this verse is saying. God works together with us in the process, even as we make mistakes, to bring out good at the end of it. So ultimately, all things will work out for good because God is involved. Life has meaning because God is involved. Life has purpose because God is involved. Don't you ever forget that. Don't forget that your life is precious to God because He bought that life, so to speak, purchased it with the precious blood of His Son. And it has meaning. It has value because of the love that He places on us. And Paul is reminding us of this. Verse 29 through 30. So verse 29 says, I'm jumping down some of these verses. Verse 29 says, for those God foreknew, He also predestined. And I'm not going to read all of that. That is one of the most, for me, powerful statements in Scripture. Because it's saying here that God already knew how the end will be. From the very beginning, before we came on the scene, He had decided how it was going to turn out. At least from His part, from His standpoint, He knows what He is going to do and how He is going to impact the process for our good. So He says here in verse 29 that for those God foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son. Now, some people limit this to just some people that God quote unquote foreknew. No, I believe this is referring to all of humanity. Before God created Adam and Eve, He foreknew. He knew ahead of time what He was doing. It wasn't by accident. And so we know Scripture also tells us that Jesus was slain before the foundation of the earth. So God knew all of us as humanity. This Scripture is referring to humans, the destiny of humans. So He's saying that whoever God foreknew, which is all of humans, He predestined all of humans, in my belief, to be conformed to the image of His Son. And that is why all of humans are made in the image of God. In other words, we are like the mold of the real thing. We bear the image. Our image bearing anticipates the natural image bearing and anticipates the spiritual glorified image bearing in Jesus Christ. The natural image bearing anticipates the ideal image bearing in Jesus that God had intended for us before we even came on the scene. That's what Paul to be saying here. So he says, those He foreknew, which is all of humanity, He predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn, the Son, that is, will be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those He predestined, He also called. Those He called, He also justified. Those He justified, He also glorified. Just basically laying out the process that we are going through in Christ to arrive at our destiny of sharing the glorified spiritual love, joy, life of Jesus. Amazing. That's the destiny God has for us as humans, and that's why our life has purpose, has meaning. And then in verses 31 through 34, we are told that God is with us in the dark and in the light, in the valleys and in the mountains. He knows our failures and our weaknesses. He doesn't condemn us as a result of our failures and weaknesses. Rather, He rescues us through Jesus, His Son, and the power of His Spirit. That's what verses 31 to 34 is saying. He's really saying, in a nutshell, that if there is anyone that has the right to condemn you and to condemn me, it is Jesus. But Jesus does not condemn. He rescues instead. He rescues instead. And we read that in verse 34. Who then is the one who condemns? He says, no one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. So not only is Jesus not condemning us, rather he is what? Interceding on our behalf. To intercede is to plead on behalf of someone, to recognize that yes, this person is messed up. Yes, this guy is weak. Yes, this girl is limited. But I ask that you consider who she is in me. You know, if we are to illustrate it, this is what's happening. Jesus does not condemn, rather he intercedes and he rescues. And then verse 35 says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all the day long. So life happens, Paul is saying, but life is not meant to separate us from the love that God has for us, which is in Jesus Christ, our Lord. However, rather, life is supposed to lead us to him, the one who does not condemn but rescues. Life is supposed to help us look up to him through his Spirit for help, because nothing can separate us from God's love for us in Jesus. And if you go down the verses, I like this verse where the title of this message comes from. It says in verse 38, for I am convinced that neither death nor life. That's an interesting way of phrasing it, isn't it? Neither death nor life. From grave to cradle or cradle to grave, nothing in between, not death itself, not life itself, can separate us, Paul says, from the love that God has for you and for me that is in Jesus. Not life's disappointments. It says neither life. You know, there was a time when I was pondering on this. Well, what did Paul mean by neither life? You know, it sounded negative because you have death and then you have life. And it says, but you see, there is substance in life, and we have a colloquialism for it. We say life happens. When we say life happens, we are saying that a lot of things occur in our lives, and sometimes they cause real repercussions. There are real consequences to life happening. And Paul is saying, no matter what it is that happens in life, whether they are life's disappointments, life's betrayals, life's suffering, life's riches or pleasures, life's triumphs or fake glories or reputations, or life's deceitfulness, whether it's life's divorce or breakups or sickness or a virus such as what we are dealing with, or a cancer or depression, from cradle to grave, Paul says, neither death nor life can separate us from the love of God for us, which is in Christ Jesus, his Son and our Lord. Isn't it amazing to have that assurance? Let's just read all of it as we finish reading Romans chapter 8. So he says, verse 38, let's start from there. For I am convinced. Now let's start from verse 37. He says, no, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. So through the topsy-turviness of life, we triumph. And we triumph through the one who loves us, and that is Jesus Christ. Right? That is God through Christ. And in verse 38, for I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. And I say amen to that. What do you say to that? I say amen to that. I say hallelujah to that. I want some of that. I want to live out life in participation with Jesus, in whom the love of God for me from cradle to grave dwells. I want to participate in a life that is rich with meaning because it is overseen by the one who is good. I know I'm not alone in this. There are many others out there listening to me now, watching me now, who are on this journey with Jesus as well. What about you? What do you say? You are invited too, you know. All of humanity is invited, as we read in verse 29. We are all predestined. We all have that destiny of sharing in the glory of God that is displayed in the face of Jesus. And that means you too. That's your destiny. Reach out to Jesus if you want to share in this life, in this journey with Him. Reach out for help if you need it. We will be glad to help. We are all in this together. As I continue to say, God does not intend for you to do life alone. He doesn't intend for me to do life alone, but to do it together, supporting and helping one another, respecting and encouraging one another as those who are made in the image of God and can share in the identity of Jesus together. So this is my prayer for you and for me, for all of us, that Lord, help us to receive your incredible destiny of sharing in the love, joy, and glory of your Son as your children. Help us to receive the truth that you are with us and for us from cradle to grave. Neither death nor whatever life throws at us can separate us from the love that you have for us in Jesus. Help us to live out this truth daily. That's what it means to live a victorious life. Help us, Lord, to trust you to ultimately work all things out for good. And even more than that, help us to trust you that you will work together with us in bringing all things out for good. And help us to live in the motivation of your Spirit, helping and supporting one another in your love as brothers and sisters, no matter what background we come from, no matter what ethnicity we come from, no matter what class we may think we are in, that we may work and support and help each other in your love as brothers and sisters to your honor and glory. Amen. I look forward to seeing you next Sunday as we journey together to know Jesus and to make him known and to share and spread his hope with a world that desperately needs hope. Let us now conclude today's worship with a praise song from Grace Communion Richardson's praise team. And I look forward to seeing you next Sunday as we continue on this journey together. God bless you.
I will soar with you.